Yes, in this we are going to see about the main memory concepts. So what are the things which you are going to see here? Let us have a look at that. Background of memory management, then swapping technique, then continuous memory allocation, paging, structure of the page table and segmentation. All these things we are going to see in the next videos. So first we will see the objective of explaining this chapter: to provide a detailed description of various ways of organizing the memory hardware and to discuss various memory management techniques including paging and segmentation. So before that, we must have some few concepts. We must review the concepts of memory management. Already in microprocessor, you should have studied the instruction assembly language and all. And how the central processing unit communicates with the main memory. You already know this is a structure which we have seen in our microprocessor. The microprocessor, it consists of, CPU consists of the accumulator. These are the temporary registers, accumulator, flip-flops, and then arithmetic logic unit. This together called as ALU. And then we have instruction decoder, which decodes the instruction which it receives from the memory, and then it decodes. What is, for example, if this is the instruction, let us consider this is the instruction MVI A32H. So this is a 2-byte instruction, and this is also a 2-byte instruction. Add B is a 1-byte instruction. Again, this is a 2-byte instruction. This is a 1-byte instruction. If there is a there are 3-byte instructions also. It depends upon the program. So if it is a first here, this is the MVI A32H. For MVI A, we have the opcode 3, and for 32, we have the opcode operand. This we call it as operand. So any instruction consists of an opcode and operands. Opcode is nothing but the operation code, and operands are where the opcode operates on those things. So MVI A32H means move the value 32 into the accumulator A. This is the meaning of this instruction. All of you know, because already you have studied the microprocessor. So how this will be represented in memory? So for example, this, since it is a 2-byte. 2-byte means this is one 8-byte. And this is another, this is only 8-bit, and this is another 8-bit. So 3E can be represented like this. See, this is 0, 0, 1, 1, 3, and E, same 32, 3 and 2. So this how it is stored in the memory. The memory has address, okay? The location, how you will recognize the row. The row wise you can recognize by its memory address. So this is stored at the location 200. And this is stored in location 2001 and so on. So this instruction itself is a 2-byte. So it is stored in the next consecutive memory locations. So now what is the purpose of the instruction decoder? It takes, so suppose we are storing, for explanation purpose, I have given it separately. But this will be, imagine this is present here. Okay. Now when we are taking this value, say for example 2000, at this memory location, if this is present and it is extracting, the data is placed on that. When the address is given by the program counter, then the data which is pointed by the program counter will be extracted, and then the program counter points to the next memory location. When it is pointing 2000, that is, first it will be taken and placed in the address, okay, that is data bus, which will be received by the internal database, and the instruction decoder decodes it. Now it decodes that this is MVI A is the instruction this, and it is not over. It has to extract the next memory also. The instruction in the next memory location also it has to extract. Then only this will be over. So that can be done by the instruction. So the instruction decoder understand that this is a 2-byte instruction. So after reading MVIA, it knows that it has to take the next data also from the next memory location. And that also will be placed on that. And together it decodes. What it decodes? The meaning of this instruction. That is, move the value of 32 into accumulator. So, and it will do that value. So the 32 will be placed in the accumulator. This is how it executes. So each time the data will be, this will be, now I am talking this as a data. So the binary instruction, which is you are passing, that will be placed on the database. In address, the control signals, what it will do, this is the control unit, and these are all the temporary registers, B, C, D, E, H, L, stack pointer, and program counter. These are all the registers in the microprocessor. Now, how the execution check, program counter will have the location of the next address to be executed. So when an instruction is executed, suppose this is executed, the program counter will be automatically incremented to point to the next location, which is nothing but 2001. When this is being executed, already the data present in this is placed on the database. Now the program counter points to this. Then after this is also over, the program counter, when this is placed on the database, now the program counter point to 2002. And this is how the sequence of execution, because after this statement, after this. So after this will be executed. So that sequence of execution is maintained by the program counter. So this is what we have seen in our microprocessor. Now this memory management is what we are going to see in this, as well as all these internal registers. So here, background. First, we will see whatever I have just now explained, all those things. Memory consists of large array of bytes, each with its own address. Let us take this as a memory unit. This has a large byte of memory, many memory, which is each is stored with its own address. Okay, so the CPU fetches instruction from memory. Yes, it fetches from the memory according to the value of the program counter, which is just now I have explained. An instruction execution cycle first fetches an instruction from the memory. Yes, it first fetches the instruction. So, for example, this instruction. In this address, there is some instruction. It first fetches and then it understands that this is not a single byte. This is a 2-byte instruction. Okay, so the instruction is then decoded and may cause operands to be fetched from the memory, whether depending upon whether it is a single byte or a 2-byte or a 3-byte. If it is a 3-byte, 3-time access from the memory is done. If it is a single byte, only 1-time access. Say for example, add B is a single byte. So after extracting, immediately it do the operation. What the value of B register will be added with the value in the accumulator and stored back in the accumulator. So after the instruction has been executed on the operand, results may be stored back in the memory. So this is how it executes. Here what we have given is out 01, that is the added value is output to the, is sent to the output, which is the port address 01. So this is how it executes. So program must be brought. What's the meaning of this is, any program, what we have seen here is primary memory, which is present in the microprocessor. So all the data which are present here only can be accessed by this, because this memory, this is called, we call it as a main memory. The data which is present in the main memory only can be accessed by the CPU. Okay, the CPU cannot, other than this, we have the physical memory, which is nothing but our hard disk or pen drive, whatever it is, which is other than this. All the other memory which is other than this primary memory, we otherwise called as primary memory, or we call it as a main memory, which is connected to the microprocessor, we call them as a secondary storage device. So in secondary storage device only we store our programs. So for example, in C drive or D drive, if you take Ubuntu, we will store it in a volumes, etc. So here let us say Windows. In C, I am writing a program today, and then what I will do, we will be storing it in our local drive. That is, in C drive, we create a folder, C or D drive, we create folders, and then we will store the program there. So what happens? It is in the secondary storage. It is not in the primary memory. Primary memory is nothing but, it is attached with a microprocessor. But a program, in order for a program to run, first you have to load that program from the secondary storage where you have stored in a folder into the main memory, which is nothing but which is attached to the primary memory, which is attached to the microprocessor. Because only the primary memory has access to the CPU. Whereas if you have secondary storage, it is not connected to them. So anything has to be first brought from the secondary storage into the main memory, and from main memory the instructions will be read by the CPU, and whatever is given in the program, that will be executed. So program must be brought from the disk When I say from the disk, it is nothing but any type of secondary storage. First, into memory. When I say memory, it is nothing but main memory and placed within your process for it to be run. Main memory and register are the only storage CPU can access directly. Yes, these are all the temporary registers, accumulator, flip-flops, instruction decoder, PCD, HL, PSP, PC. These are all the registers which are present. As well. When I say register, they are also a storage unit. So they are attached to the, they are all hardwire connected. Okay, so they have only these storage and the main memory only are connected with each other, not the secondary storage. The secondary storage is connected to the memory. So the data from secondary storage will be placed in the main memory, and then from there it will pass to the respective registers and do the operations. So registers built in CPU are accessible in one cycle. Since they are connected with the CPU, registers are directly, for example, all these accumulator, all these things, they are connected directly with the central processing unit, that is CPU. When you brought the data here, it will be executed very fast. As they are hardwired, they will be getting executed fast. Whereas the data which is present in the main memory, it is somewhat slower than the register, because registers are the very fast memory as they are directly connected with the CPU, whereas this is connected with some wires. My main memory is also connected, but still it is not exactly connected with the registers. It is connected with the buses, which is nothing but address bus and control data bus, as well as the signals are also connected. So here, through the address bus, it will place the address, then it will be read from the data, the instruction will be read, and it is placed in the database, which in turn will go to the. So this process is there in main memory. So somewhat, this is slower than the registers which are stored there. Whereas if you take secondary storage, they are very slow, because when compared to the main memory, they are not at all connected to this register. At least here it is connected with address bus and database, whereas secondary storage is not at all connected with this thing. It is connected only with the memory. So from there, the memory, the data will be loaded into memory. So the secondary storage is still slower. So instruction from main memory can take many cycles. That is why these two statements, registers has, it will be completed in one cycle of CPU clock, whereas instruction from main memory can take many cycles. The processor has to wait to get data required to complete the instruction. So it has to wait till the data arrives in its data bus. The situation becomes intolerable because of frequency of memory access. Because if you say for this, it has to, anything has to be accessed. So there are a lot of memory access, and again, it has to read from memory after the work is over, after addition, subtract, whatever it is, over the processor, it will be written back into the memory. So reading and writing is very, very large than the processing. Reading and writing is done, because we have so many programs that will be loaded first, and then it will be carried over by the CPU, and it will be written. CPU is very fast. It wait for the accessing is done fast, but and it will do the processing also fast. The situation becomes very tall, but it keeps in lot of frequent access to the memory access, then actually the system will slow down. So the remedy for this is to use one more memory called cache memory, a fast memory that sits between the main memory and CPU registers. So it sits between these two, between the main memory and the CPU. So what is the use of this? Say for example, if you have a program which has a for loop, which has a while loop, it keeps on doing the same repeated things, those type of instructions can be placed in cache memory, some repeated operations again and again. So if those things has to be taken from the main memory, it will slow it down. Instead, if those type of instructions which are having a repeated access are placed in cache memory, the CPU can directly take it from the cache memory and place it in the register, which is very fast. So that is why between these two, we have one more memory called cache memory. Protection of memory is required to ensure the correct operation. What do you mean by this? So here, let us see this. This is an memory is represented like this. The first few space will be occupied by the operating system. Then we have one user process, another user process, another user process, and so on. Now, the user process one, let us take this as a user process one. This should not act accidentally or unaccidentally. It should not enter into this operating system coding. If this user is having access to this portions in this, then they will try to modify, which will lead to the crash down of the operating system. Likewise, this process, this user should not enter. He should not go here and change the lines in the processor too. Same way, this user program should not go and intervene in this and change that line. So that is what we mean by the protection of memory required to ensure the correct operation. So one user program should not enter into another user program. This user program should not enter, as well as the user's program should not disturb the operating system coding also. That is what we should give the correct protection to ensure that one user will not go away from his limited portion. So when I say user, it is nothing but programs, many programs. So here, that is why it is given as process one, process. Oh, let us take this process one. This may be one program, another program. So that means nothing. But when in memory, when more than one program reside, then we call it as a multi-programming. So here, in order to achieve the multi-programming, we have to make sure that one program should not disturb the other program as well as operating system. So we will see in the next video how this is maintained.